الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وسيد المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين سيدنا ونبينا أبي القاسم محمد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد ثم الصلاة والسلام على أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين المنتجبين لا سيما مولانا وسيدي صاحب الأصل والزمان اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد روحي وأرواح العالمين له الفداء وأجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف ولعنة دائمة على أعدائهم ومنكر فضائلهم من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين أما بعد فقد قال الله الحكيم في كتابه المبين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وكونوا مع الصادقين صلوا على محمد وآل محمد
صلي على محمد آل محمد
My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. As we begin this Friday sermon for today, I first off remind myself, as I remind all of you, and I take this time to remind my nafs before all of you to have the taqwa of Allah, to have the consciousness and awareness of Allah within our lives, and to always realize that Allah is ever present over our actions, over our speech, and over our thoughts. And that all of these will be held either for or against us on the Day of Judgment. And so therefore on this blessed day, we remind ourselves to be ever aware of the presence of Allah within our lives. And on this blessed day of Friday, we also ask Allah, we praise Allah for the blessings which He has given to us. The countless blessings which Allah says in the Quran, where we to try and count the blessings of Allah, that we would not be able to do so. And obviously the best of all of the blessings that Allah has favored upon all of us is that we are followers of the final religion and the final prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
And we send our prayers and salutations upon Rasulullah and upon the Ahlul Bayt of Rasul, upon the daughter of the prophet, upon Amir al-Mu'mineen and all of the imams, and especially our 12th and awaited Savior, Imam al-Hujjat, ajjalallahu ta'ala farajuhu sharif.
Salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
As we know, we're on the periphery of the night of Ashura. Tomorrow will be the day of Ashura, a day which will go down in history as the day of the greatest sacrifice that any human being has ever given in his lifetime. And obviously the majlis tonight and tomorrow will be dedicated to the events of Ashura. But today, just for the few minutes that I wanted to speak to you about the Ahlul Bayt alayhum as-salam, one of the things that we see, and this is becoming more and more prevalent today around the world, is that more and more people are becoming acquainted with the Ahlul Bayt alayhum as-salam. Obviously, we have many campaigns that have been happening around the world. We have literature which is being published and disseminated. We have websites, we have television stations which are promoting the pure message of Ali Muhammad alayhi wasalam. And the name of the Ahlul Bayt is making its way into homes where previously it never was. And again, you just have to look at many of the media channels and outlets to see that even major news stations around the world cover the events of Ashura. And they commemorate, they cover the commemoration and the millions of people who make it to Karbala, either on the day of Ashura or also on the day of Arba'in. We also know and appreciate that amongst the non-Shias, the other Muslims who are there within the community of believers, that traditionally they have had a love and affection for Ali Muhammad alayhum as-salam.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
But unfortunately, due to the petrodollars that come out of the Gulf, especially few of the countries who promote an ideology which many times is seen as an opponent to the Ali Muhammad alayhum as-salam, that they have spent not only millions, but billions of dollars to promote an ideology which goes against the teachings of Ali Muhammad, and in some cases even to promote teachings against the family of the Prophet themselves. Forget about their followers, but against the Ahlul Bayt alayhum as-salam themselves. Today I want to share with us just a few hadith from a book which is written by a very prominent Sunni scholar about 500 years ago. And he has over 700 books to his credit. A very prominent scholar named Imam Jalaluddin al-Suyuti. Many have probably heard his name. You've seen his commentary of the Quran, some of it which is available in English and other languages. And he obviously is not a direct follower of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam as we know it. But he has written a book which, interestingly enough, was made available on the internet by a group in Canada called the Islamic Supreme Council of Canada. They're a group of brothers from the Ahlul Sunnah, and they have a mandate of propagation and education, but they made this book available in English online to show the love that Muslims in general need to have towards the Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. And even if you look at the title of the name of his book, he calls it Al-Ihya'ul Mayyit Bifadail Ahlul Bayt, which when they rendered into English, they called it The Dead Become Alive by the Grace of the Holy Five. The dead become alive by the grace of the Holy Five. What a beautiful title for a book, that our hearts, the dead heart of a human being, of a Muslim, can become enlivened, can have a second life through the fada'il of the Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salatu was-salam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. And in this book, again, which you can find online for free reading, he quotes and he narrates 60 different hadith about the fadilat of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. I just want to share maybe two of them with us today. The first tradition, not in the order of the sequence, but one of the first traditions he talks about is the hadith of Thaqalain. This is a hadith, I'm sure, a tradition from the words of Rasulullah that many of us have heard about, where the Prophet was on the final Hajj, which, as we know, just was a few weeks ago, where we marked the event of the Hajj, Dhul Hijjah. And we know that that was the first and the last Hajj that the Prophet ever performed. He only did one Hajj within his entire lifetime. And in this Hajj, this farewell Hajj, the Prophet obviously was acquainting the believers with the rites of the pilgrimage, what to perform, all of the rules that they would need in terms of the Hajj rituals, as much as was possible at that time. And we know that eventually, before the end, before they reach back to Medina, that he stops the entire caravan. We know the entire event of Ghadir. I don't want to go through that event again. But he makes a statement, Rasulullah makes a statement, where he says that, I'm about to leave you. Allah has called me and I will be going back to Allah, but that I leave behind me two weighty things, that if you follow both of them, he says that you would never go astray. And obviously the hundreds of thousands of companions were waiting to hear, what is it that Rasulullah is leaving behind that would guarantee the salvation of the Muslim Ummah until the day of resurrection? And that is where he says that I leave behind the Quran and my Ahlul Bayt, my family. And that these two will never separate from one another, and that they will meet me at the pool of Kawthar on the day of resurrection. And Imam Suyuti doesn't mention this hadith just once. It comes at least 8 or 10 times in this collection of hadith, through different narrators, through different sources that he is quoting from. So this, first of all, shows us the importance of holding on to both the Quran and the Ahlul Bayt. And us as followers of Ahlul Bayt, us as who claim to follow Ahlul Bayt, we have to realize that both of these are equally important. The Quran is as important as the Ahlul Bayt. We can't be called Muslims or lovers of Ali Muhammad if we just come to the majalis, we just beat our chest, we just lament, but then we throw the Quran on the shelf and we wait till Ramadan comes, Shahr Ramadan, to recite the Quran. Nor can a Muslim claim to be on the path of guidance if they only read the Quran and interpret the Quran and they neglect the family of the Prophet, Ali Muhammad. So we have to appreciate both have a central role to play within our lives, that we have to read the Quran at the first level, understand the Quran, go through commentaries of the Quran, and all of this becomes a precursor to be able to implement the Quranic teachings within our lives. And obviously, once we are able to learn and appreciate and read and take in the Quran, then we can go and learn the life of Ali Muhammad, what their message was, which we will see is merely a practical implementation of the ayat of the Quran. And putting both of these together, we'll be able to move forward towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hadith number two, though, when you look at this book and you go to the second hadith that Suyuti narrates, he gives us the answer of who the Ahlul Bayt are. Because even within the world of Islam today, there is this dilemma there is this problem or question that who are the Ahlul Bayt? Are they four or five members? Are they all of the companions of the Prophet? Are they the wives of the Prophet? Are they the Ummah of Rasulullah? Many different definitions have been given by contemporary and traditional scholars to answer the question of who are the Ahlul Bayt. Because if the Prophet says to follow two things, we need to know who these individuals are. We know the Quran. We all have the Quran on our bookshelves, on our smartphones, on our tablets. That's easy to access. We know what the Quran is. But then the question will come, well, somebody will say, well, who are the Ahlul Bayt that we have been obliged to follow? And the Prophet did not leave us in confusion or in the darkness without pinpointing who these individuals are. So in the second hadith that he quotes in his book, As-Suyuti quotes from his own chain of narrators, from Tabarani, from Ibn Abbas, who was a very known companion of Rasulullah, that he says, when the verse of the Quran came down, كُلَّ أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرًا إِلَّا الْمَوَدَّةَ فِي الْقُرْبَى, that I ask you no reward except love for the family, for the qurba. They said, O Messenger of Allah, who are your nearest relatives that love is made obligatory upon them? So they wanted to know, who are the dhil qurba? Who are these Ahlul Bayt that we are obligated, that it is wajib to show love and affection for? And he narrates in the hadith that the Prophet says that they are Ali, Fatima, and their two sons. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
Ali Muhammad.
And so this shows us that the Ahlul Kisa that he says give life to the dead are none other than these four individuals. And obviously Rasulullah being a part of that family. And as an extension, we also extend it to the 12 Imams, because the Prophet had indicated, although he doesn't mention this hadith in his collection, but other traditions talk about how Rasulullah mentioned the 12 Imams by name, each of the Imams by name and their titles. So Al-Baqir, As-Sadiq, Al-Kadhim, they were all there. And one of the references to this is when you look in the actual entire sermon of Ghadir, which was a two-hour khutbah Rasulullah gave, he mentioned each of the Imams by name within that tradition. So we see the Ahlul Qisa are limited to five that were under that blanket in the revelation of chapter 33, verse 33. And the remainder of the Imams from the progeny of Hussein up until our 12th Imam basically complete this family of purity, of infallibility, and those that we are obligated to love and to follow, and who are equals of the Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed. Let me mention one more hadith and we'll end the first sermon with this. Is on the status of Imam Hassan and Hussein alayhim as-salam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Now I'm sure we've all heard the hadith of Rasulullah where he said, Al-Hassan wal-Hussein, Sayyidi Shababi Ahlil Jannah, that Hassan and Hussein are the leaders, are the masters of the youth of paradise. And we know that the Prophet has talked about Imam Hassan and Hussein, saying that they are leaders, they are imams, whether they take a stand and rise up and have what we call a revolution against the corruption of their time, or if they have to take a back seat because of political expediency. In either case, the Prophet said they are leaders and we are obligated to follow them. And I know we've all also heard stories about how the Prophet would show his love and affection to his grandchildren. So much so that even as the traditions mention that he would be in the state of prayers and the children would be there and playing with the Prophet and he would not disturb his prayers. That he took time to play with his grandchildren. He would be hugging them, loving them, showing them that love and compassion of a grandfather to his grandchildren. And obviously even more because these are the leaders of the Ummah after him. But in this book, in hadith number 30, As-Suyuti quotes a tradition on the status of the children. Well, we call them the children of Ali and Fatima alayhim as-salam. But let's see what he says in the hadith. Again, quoting from his sources, he quotes Fatima Zahra alayhi as-salam as saying the following. He says that the Prophet has said, so now he's quoting a chain of narrators saying that Bibi Fatima alayhi as-salam is quoting her father, the Rasulullah, as saying the following, that the sons of every mother are referred to by the relation of their father. So for example, if you have a son, if your name is Hassan and your son's name is Ali, he's Ali the son of Hassan. He doesn't get attributed to anybody else within the Islamic terminology. So Lady Zahra says, quoting the Prophet, that the sons of every mother are referred to by their relation to their father, except the sons of Fatima. I am their guardian and they are my sons. The Prophet is saying that all children go back to the lineage of their father except for the sons of Fatima, that they are my children in actuality. And this is not something surprising. You may think, well, this is a strange hadith, but we know in the event of Mubahala, which we mark at the end of the month of Dhul-Hijjah, that the Messenger of Allah, when he has invited the Christians of Najran, of what we look at present-day Yemen, to come and enter into interfaith dialogue and discussion, because the Christians believed, and still a majority today, as we know, believe in the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, that there are three entities, but they are unique from one another, but only one God, as they claim. When the Christians of Najran had this belief, and they wanted to come and debate Rasulullah, we know that they made their way to Medina, they entered into dialogue with the Messenger of Allah, and eventually when the point got to that level where they were not willing to accept this logic of not being possible to have three gods as one, the issue of a mubahala, this mutual imprecation, came up. And the verse mentions to the Prophet, he says that if these people, the Christians, still argue with you concerning the status of Jesus, then say to them, come, let us call our sons and your sons, and let us call our women and your women, and ourselves and yourselves, and then let us ask Allah for the curse to be on those who are the people who are not telling the truth, who are the liars. And we know that when this verse came about, that the Prophet had many companions, he had many wives, he had many people who were around him. But we know that when it came to the nafs, he only calls Amir al-Mu'mineen. When it comes to the nisa, to the women, he had multiple wives. Many of the wives were in Medina with Rasulullah when this verse came, but he brings his daughter, Lady Zahra, alayha salam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. And when it comes to the sons, he brings Imam Hassan and Hussein, alayhi salam, even though they're not his biological children, they're his grandchildren. But from the verse of the Quran, Allah says, bring your sons, and he brings these two young boys. So we see how this verse of the Quran is in line with the hadith from the Prophet to Lady Zahra, that all children go back to their father except for these two, that they belong, that they are in actuality the spiritual children of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. And so let us end here, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we mark these tragic nights of Muharram, and especially tonight, tomorrow, and not only these few nights, but that we continue to mourn the tragedy of Karbala, because really what happens after Karbala is as tragic and sorrowful as the day of Ashura is. But we ask Allah to give all of us the ability to continue to lament and mourn the tragedy of Karbala. And we ask Allah that we're all able to listen to the majalis wherever they may be held, and that we can take a lesson from the messages being given through our scholarship, and that we can make a positive change within our lives in these nights of Muharram, and that we can come out as better believers in the message of Ali Muhammad, and that we can be ready to stand for the truth, just as Sayyidah Shuhada was ready to do on the 61st year after the Hijrah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Inna a'atainaka al-kawthar, fasalli li rabbika wanhar. Inna shani'aka huwa al-abatar.
Salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
A'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Wassalatu wassalam ala ashrafil anbiya wa sayyidil mursalin wa shafiil mudhnibin sayyidina wa nabiyyina Abil Qasim Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Wassalatu wassalam ala amirul mu'minin wa ya'subuddin Maulana Ali ibn Abi Talib.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Wassalatu wassalam ala badat al-Nabi wal umma al-a'imma Fatima al-Zahra salawatullahi wassalamuhu alayha.
Salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Wassalatu wassalamu ala sayyidi shababi ahlil jannah imam al-hasani wal-husayn alayhum wassalatu wassalam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. Allahumma salli wa sallim ala aimatul muslimin Ali ibn Hussein wa Muhammad ibn Ali wa Ja'far ibn Muhammad wa Musa ibn Ja'far wa Ali ibn Musa wa Muhammad ibn Ali wa Ali ibn Muhammad wa al-Hasan ibn Ali. Allahumma salli wa sallim ala qa'im ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
Ali Muhammad.
حججك على عبادك وأمنائك في بلادك صلاة كثيرة دائما اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات وتابع بيننا وبينهم بالخيرات إنك مجيب الدعوات وإنك رافع الدرجات وإنك على كل شيء قدير اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد أما بعد فقد قال الله الحكيم في كتابه المبين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما صدق الله العلي العظيم صلوا على محمد وآل محمد اللهم صل على محمد. Once again, in this second sermon, I begin by reminding myself, as I remind all of you, to have the taqwa of Allah. And as Allah mentions in this verse, which I just started with, that not only have the taqwa of Allah, but He says, وَقُولُوا قَوْلًا سَدِيدًا, to speak a true word, speak a straight word. And this is a challenge sometimes. We sometimes say one thing and mean another thing. Or we say one thing and we do something completely opposite. Not because we're not able to, but because of the fact that sometimes we don't want to do certain things that we say. And so Allah reminds us to have the taqwa of Allah. One of the aspects of being conscious of Allah within our lives is to always be truthful. When we say something, we should mean it. When we say that we're going to do something, we should do it. We need to follow up our words with our actions. And this is, again, a commandment that helps us to go further in our taqwa, in our consciousness of Allah, that we are able to ensure that what is in the heart is actually translated into our actions and how we deal with humanity. The second sermon is usually devoted to political events around the world. And, you know, when you look, obviously, at the world that we're living in today, it's not a beautiful place to be. We have so many challenges around the world. Last week, we touched upon the refugee plight of all the people who are fleeing many of the war-torn countries and are coming to the shores of Europe. And we mentioned also how we should do our best to help these individuals in any way possible. Alhamdulillah, one of the things we noticed by looking at the news at least is that this Muharram has been relatively peaceful. Traditionally in the past, and I'm sure many of us know that many of our centers have been attacked in many parts of the world. Many innocent men and women and children who have gathered to commemorate the martyrdom of Imam Hussein have lost their own lives in the commemoration of the loss of Abi Abdullah. And this year, alhamdulillah, except for one or two, obviously there was still a bombing I read about in Pakistan just yesterday, I believe it was, with 10 people who were killed in an attack. But fortunately, thanks be to Allah, that we haven't seen that widespread carnage that we have in recent years. And obviously we have to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the security and the safety that we have been given across the world as believers to partake in the majalis of Sayyid al-Shuhada, Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wassalam.
Salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
And obviously at the same time, we still realize that there is still a lot of difficulty in the world. And again, I don't want to mention a lot of the countries, but we know when we look in the media or a lot of our local and international organizations that much is still being done to help raise funds and support for many of the refugees and many of the people who are suffering around the world. And so just as a reminder for that as we get ready to commemorate the Day of Ashura, that we commemorate this supreme sacrifice that Sayyid al-Shuhada gave on the Day of Ashura for the protection of Islam, for the protection of the teachings of Ali Muhammad, we ensure that we are also able to safeguard and protect and help those who are less fortunate than us, that we can do what it is that we are able to do for the betterment of our own community first and foremost, that we make sure our own community is taken care of, and then we also look beyond our borders to ensure that those who are also in difficulties are given the support that they need. And inshallah, we ask Allah to accept our acts of worship in these nights of Muharram. Again, we ask Allah to allow us to understand the message of Karbala, to ensure that we are able to implement the message of Karbala within our lives, that our children are able to get the proper message of Karbala, that they can grow up to be supporters of the Ahlul Bayt alayhum as-salam, and that they can carry on this torch of mentioning Imam Hussein alayhi salam and to keep his memory alive. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد صدق الله العلي العظيم صلوا على محمد وآل محمد